The name of this video is Distribution of Dipoles. Why is this video very important, this and the next one? Because it's at the basis for dielectric materials. So this is the mathematical foundation for understanding the math of dielectric materials. So let us consider, first of all, a discrete, to begin with, distribution, as we have done for charges in 242, in Phys 242. We first consider a discrete distribution of charges in space. Now we consider a discrete distribution, instead of charges, of electric dipoles. Of capital N, quasi-ideal or ideal, dipoles. Okay, so that's what I'm considering, discrete. And again, keyword for now, discrete. Okay, so if I have a huge region of space within this universe, which is this rectangle here, within this region, I focus on this region here, which let's say is characterized by a volume delta V, in such a way that the cubic root of delta V is much larger than the mean value of capital D, where the mean value of capital D is the mean distance between two dipoles. So in here, for example, we can have, this is one dipole with distance here D1, this is another dipole with distance D2 dotted, this can be a dipole with distance, let's call it d small n, and finally we can have a dipole with distance d capital N. So the mean value is that. So if this is the case, so this is an physics infinitesimal within my universe, okay? So again, now the key idea here, instead of considering a distribution of charges like we've done in 242, it's a distribution of electric dipoles. And in physics, in what is a typical case where we have a distribution of dipoles instead of charges? Dielectric materials, insulators. Those are distribution of dipoles, molecules with positive and negative charge, okay? Which are ideal, quasi-ideal dipoles. That is why it's important. All right. So if this is the situation, this means that each of these dipoles is characterized by a dipole moment pi. Or actually, since we use the index n, let me call it pn, okay? It's p small n, to be consistent with this sketch up here. So p small n is the dipole moment for one generic nth dipole, electric dipole within this region of space. So then within this region of space, physics infinitesimal delta b, okay? What is the effective dipole moment delta p associated with this region of space? Well, this is nothing but the sum of all dipole moments in that region of space. So it's going to be the sum for small n, which goes from 1 to capital N, of Pn. I just sum them up, and that's what I get. Now, from this definition here, which is a vector, can I find something which is independent? You see, this one is strongly dependent on this volume. So can we get rid of this dependence on the volume? So how do we typically do that in physics? Well, the way we do it is by dividing by that volume. And so we can go from this delta p to a new function, which we call vector p. This is vector p, okay? Vector p at point capital Q. In general, if this is if this delta v is in the neighborhood of a point capital Q, let's call it here. Well, this quantity, I just define it in the discrete case as delta p normalized over delta v, delta must be the volume. So in other words, this is nothing but the density of dipole moments around capital Q. It's a density, which in this case is a vector. Okay, so let me make a sketch here where on the left I discuss dipole moments, and on the right charges. So here I have dipole distributions. Dipole distributions, and here I have charge distributions. just to compare to what we have done in 242 for charges. We are extending the concept basically if you want. So then in this case, the key quantity which represents dipole distributions is P. Let me extrapolate immediately to the continuum, to the continuous case. So in the continuous case, so let's extrapolate everything up here, going now to the continuous charge distribution. So we go from discrete to continuous charge distributions in this table up here. So in the case of continuous, obviously this delta becomes a derivative like we've done for charges. So let me remind you in fact here that rho at any point capital Q, which is a source charge point, is given by the derivative of Q over the volume V computed around that point capital Q. It was one of the first videos in 242. So this is a scalar for charges. For dipoles, we have, instead of a scalar, a vector P, a capital Q, which is given by the derivative of P, which is a vector, that's why this is a vector and this is a scalar, divided by dV, computed around point capital Q. So you can see here, back to back, the comparison between these two quantities. Scalar for charges, vector for dipoles. These are the densities of charges here and dipoles there. All right, great. So now we know what are the densities. Let me make a little sketch to further understand what's going on here. So in the case of dipoles, basically we have, let's say, a region of space like this, which we call capital omega, characterized by P, a dipole density vector at point capital Q, whereas here we have the same thing, but we had, in this case, we had omega and rho scalar around the point Q. Okay, so if I consider now a certain origin here, I call this the origin O, and this is an observation point, capital P, so this vector here, we will define it in a minute. So this is vector R, okay, the distance from the observation point and a generic origin of all vectors O, whereas if I consider here a point, capital Q, in the neighborhood of which there are a number of dipoles, like this, etc. So I consider this region, which in 3D would be a little volume, and so this is in the neighborhood of a point capital Q, around which I have a volume dV, which later on I will call dr prime cube for consistency with previous notation. Okay, dV here was for simplicity. And so in this neighborhood, which is 3D, of course, in three dimension, on the board here is just 2D. So this distance here from O to the point capital Q, we call it R prime. Therefore, the distance between capital Q and P, let me show this in green, because it's quite important for the next step. So this quantity is R minus R prime, as we have seen previously. Okay. And similarly, for charges, we would have the neighborhood here of a certain point, capital Q. But there we had positive and negative charges instead of dipoles, okay? And there is rho, which is a scalar, representing the density of those charges in that case. Now, what is interesting here is that so if I now consider just an infinitesimal volume dV, which is the R prime cube, what is the electrostatic potential dV at distance r at the observation point capital P due to all these dipoles located around capital Q? Obviously, I can use an equal sign because these are ideal or quasi-ideal dipoles. Therefore, the equal sign is allowed. And so it's 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught times dP. So now you need to remember the equation we found before. The equation we found was 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught p dot r over r cube. So in this case, p becomes, because it's just for an infinitesimal volume, is dp dotted with what? Okay. In the equation we found before, it was dotted r over r cube. Now here you're tempted, and students are tempted to say r over r cube. No, that is wrong. It is dotted with r minus r prime divided by the absolute value of r minus r prime quantity cube. Okay, so why is it that now we cannot use R? Why instead of R we use R minus R prime, and before we didn't do that? This is a fundamental concept. And the concept, let me explain it in this space here. So let me close this like this. I want to explain this because this is a typical mistake that many students do, and is worth repeating here. And I'm sure it's not clear yet. So in what we have done up until now, so in the previous videos, we had a region of space, capital omega, with a certain charge density rho, not a dipole distribution, exactly a charge distribution. And so we chose an origin of all vectors, let's call it O, which I can choose anywhere I want, okay? Then we replaced effectively this region of space, we replace it in an approximation, which is the multiple series expansion, with just one dipole, negative, positive, with a certain distance between them from negative to positive, which is dr, let's say, okay? And then we consider that somehow this is located right at O, the origin O, okay? This origin is actually this point here, okay? And so this distance where I observe, I just call it R, and this is my point capital P, where I observe, and I find P dot R over R cubed, okay? So here we have this P dot R, 1 over 5 epsilon naught, of course, divided by R cubed. Okay, and I forgot the one, I don't put 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught, let me say approximately that. So what we did up until now was, we had a region of space where there is a charge density. We replaced this charge density in first order approximation with one dipole. Okay, so that's, it's an approximation. We just replace it with a dipole. And then, of course, we are considering the case where the charge is zero, the monopole is zero. So then I don't consider quadrupoles, I just stop at the dipole, which means all this mass with charge here, it becomes a single dipole, okay, with this equation here. Now, what we are doing here, we are extrapolating, and instead of having a charge distribution which we approximate with dipole, we start from already the approximation, but many of them, many dipoles, like in this case here. So we have many dipoles. And now, what is the distance? So we have many dipoles. The actual distance from any of these dipoles in the neighborhood, any point, capital Q, which is a source point for the dipoles, to the observation point is not R anymore, it's R minus R prime. Again, because we're not just approximating the dipole, we are having many of them. We have a distribution. That's the beauty of this. So it's not R, it's not R minus R prime. It is not a mistake, because it is different. Now we have a distribution of many of them, not just one. Okay, for one, we just had that, of course, the potential, the faraway potential for this can be approximated speed of R. And because, of course, also I'm concentrating everything around the dipole, so R minus R prime is actually basically R, if you want, because we know that R prime is very small compared to R. Here, you cannot do it because you really need to tell the person who has to do this calculation where these dipoles are located in this region in order to find everywhere. Because I'm not approximating it. Okay, so if you were to do to forget about this R prime, you were kind of making the approximation of the approximation, but we are not. Okay, so it's not the approximation of the approximation. This was an approximation, and then we have many of these approximations. And I need to know, when I compute the integral, where they are distributed, because I have a distribution of them, and I want to find this everywhere exactly. Not only far away, but everywhere, okay? Everywhere, no approximation of the approximation. Okay, I hope this is clear, because I know that there are many problems with that. You can, of course, ask questions in Piazza if it's still not clear after these words. So finally, V of R can be written as 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught. Now we integrate, and I need to know where to integrate with respect to R prime in capital omega. Now dp is actually p times dv, so we can rewrite it. It's worth rewriting it as capital P at point R prime. This one is dotted with R minus R prime, okay, divided by R minus R prime quantity cube. And here I need to put the dr prime cube. So what I did, I exchanged my deep small p with p capital P times dv from here, okay? Capital P dot dv. And of course the rest I keep it exactly the same. Later on in dielectric materials, we will specialize this capital P, will be just called eventually in dielectrics, this capital P becomes simply this p, polarization vector. I prefer not to call it like this yet here, Because in principle, this does not apply only to the dipoles of a dielectric material, of an insulator, but to anything. So it's worth distinguishing between this capital P, which can be applied to any distribution of dipoles, compared to this P, which is the polarization vector specific to dielectric materials. All right, so let me summarize this video. So in this video, we consider distribution dipoles. Why does it matter? Because it's useful to understand dielectric materials. We start S for charges with discrete dipoles, quasi-ideal dipoles, capital N of them in a region delta V, which is a physics infinitesimal. Of course, I have many more everywhere else. I can define the total delta P in this region, summing up all the dipole moments in this region. Divided by delta V, I find the density. If I do the derivative, I go basically from the discrete to a continuous charge dipole distribution. For charges, we have a scalar, rho equal dq over dv. For dipoles, a vector, capital P, dp over dv. Now I have a distribution of dipoles, the potential due to an infinitesimal volume of dipoles anywhere, not only far away, is given by this equation, and that is why it's r minus r prime over r minus r prime cube, is not that just r, which was the approximation to find a charge reduced to a single dipole. Here we have many dipoles. Then I integrate over these dipoles, and this is what I get, and eventually it's going to be useful for the polarization vector. That's it.